हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल। हाँ If we recollect what we have discussed before the sessions on Docker, then we have completed mostly about the asynchronous kind of communication earlier. So that was related to the API calls, and then we had on the basis of gRPC, so how you can have your client and server talking with each other. And I think some of you already implemented that as well in lab session. So that was on the synchronous communication mainly. And gRPC also has the provision for like asynchronous communication. But we are having some more detailed examples to discuss today and maybe afternoon session as well. So that will be on the basis of actually the message queuing concept. So we'll have some basics on message queuing concepts and some tools also which are available for like using with any language. Again, so that freedom will be there always, whatever language you want to use for implementing your application. So we'll have some maybe demo also. I'll just try to arrange that. And before we exactly start discussing about the asynchronous communication, I'll just give one example so that will give you a clear-cut idea about like how there can be a difference between synchronous communication and asynchronous communication in your application, and the applications will be looking very simple. Okay, so I'm just giving some pointers to that, and the links will I'll provide in LMS later, and you can explore that part also. So here we have an example of a service composition based application where we have like multiple services. So this is actually example based on the Beldrina language. So this language has actually very good literature available, and you can easily pick it up if you want to exactly apply that and learn the concepts of various microservices related the demonstrations if you want to try out. So that is possible very easily, right? That's why I'm referring to this various examples which are in Ballerina. So service composition, there we have the travel booking service. Mostly we have three types of booking possibilities here. So in the front we have like a travel agency service, and then in back end we have a few more services. So this may be like the third party services which may not be actually under the ownership of the like first service, right? That is travel agency service. So to the user, the exposure of this particular application is only in the form of the front service, that is the travel agency service. And then after this particular service, maybe later on carrying out this particular task of interacting with the rest of the services, and accordingly there can be responses coming in from various this bookings possible. So whether it is airline or hotel booking or it is the vehicle booking. So that is the conceptual diagram we have. And in this case, we have the clear-cut demarcation that this will be a kind of the communication. If I ask like what will be the communication in the front, if someone can reply before we discuss exactly the technicalities of this application. So if someone can reply, what will be the kind of communication which we have in front? Any responses we can have? What will be the communication mode between client and the travel agency service? We have some response that is risk based. Okay, so that we call Savan also has replied. So that will be obviously yes, risk based this request response. So what is the mode of that communication? Whether it is synchronous or it is asynchronous? Neil is replying that is synchronous communication will have. So that's the correct one. In the front end, whatever communication we make with this travel agency service, right? So that is the synchronous communication. And whatever communications we have in this example, right? So that is also a kind of synchronous communication only. But we have also other examples. Quickly, I'll go through mostly the diagrams, not only code. I'll go through each of them. Maybe one, this example, I'll just go through the code quickly. But I'll not scan the code of other applications which I've opened in the browser. But just to give an idea, like how your application can be exactly designed on this line. So wherever you need, there can be synchronous communication, and somewhere there can be need of asynchronous communication. But in this particular example, whatever we have, so in front, we have obviously the synchronous communication. in the back end also, the communication we have is also a kind of synchronous communication. So if we look at the code of this, so I'll not explain the full code, but we have some I think boilerplate code available somewhere. So I'll just go through that. Otherwise, this is fully available as a repository. You can get that and check that code later on. But we have this top four different services composition, and each has like its business logic in terms of this Ballerina code. So that carries the business logic, and there are subsequent commands to actually create various modules of your service. So if you install Ballerina, I'll specify version if you want to try this out. So you'll be exactly regenerate these scenarios, and this will give you some more confidence in terms of the application building and designing various modules and how they can interact together. Okay. So if we check this travel agency service code quickly, then we have a listener on 9090, right? So, and there we have a travel agency endpoint handle created. So exactly we are talking about the front part of this. So over here we have declared the listener on code number 9090. So to this particular user, the service will be available on code number 9090. And then after we have various other endpoint declarations. So that is either the airline reservation, or it is hotel reservation, or maybe it is a vehicle booking, and all of them are again available on a specific endpoint, that is airline, hotel, and car. Okay, so this is just setting the endpoints with the three or four like accommodation or travel, whatever requirements we have, so that we have arranged before we go ahead with the service composition, that is our front service, right? So now we have something on this line, how we handle the calls to various services from this core of your application. So that is travel agency service, right? So if we check that, again, this is not a complete code, only conceptual code we have, and then we have some repetitions existing in between. So in this, it's exactly we are declaring a base path on which your service will be available. So just like hotel, car, we have this particular service, travel booking also will be available on travel, right? And then we declare service inside the this particular code. So that is in the context of Ballerina language. So we are declaring a agency service, and that is available on endpoint so and so. So that is your endpoint binding. And then after, within that particular service, we have a declaration of various methods. So one of them is like arrange tour. So that arrange tour is expecting there has to be a post approach for this. So post method will be taking care of that, and request and response. So that is consuming or producing, right? And then after, we have the HTTP response kind of new object creation, and that you can use to respond back to the user. And then we have some details which may be arriving from the user, that is name and other details. So these are the trip details a user is likely to provide. And then we can have the parsing of this particular information which may be arriving from the client. So that will be in this particular parameter, and the caller details, how to talk back to that particular client, will be available in this parameter. So once you have done this reservation by like airline or hotel booking or car, then we are responding back to the user that yes, your journey is booked as per your preferences, whatever you have provided, right? So that is just a boilerplate code we have for the front service. And rest of this, this is like a trivial code. It is just parsing the stuff which has arrived from the user, so like arrival date, departure, and whatever airline accommodation and vehicle preferences. So from that, it is just trying to retrieve the details, and accordingly, then it will use it further to talk with the backend services from this point, right? So that was a quick understanding of the application, which is based on service composition idea. And there we have multiple services interacting with each other. And this is exactly the request response type of communication. Over here also we have request and response type of communication. So this complete application is based on the synchronous line, right? So if we just check one service, then it will give you idea. If we have one service code at least, this is your main service. I'm looking for another service implementation we have. This is again your main service code only. Okay, you can check the full code then on this page. I think for individual service we don't have the code, but we can check this airline or hotel reservation or car. So they again must be declaring the endpoints like on 9091, 9092, and 9093. And similarly, they must be implementing the methods which we are actually going to call, like hotel, car, or travel, right? So the way this method is implemented, like arrange tour, so similarly, this methods also must have been implemented in the code what we have inside airline, hotel, or car rental. So that you can check later on. We are not going through that full code now, but that was just to explain how you can have a like a synchronous communication based application. And now we have some more examples on the same line. So over here we have in between the a message broker, which will be actually taking care of carrying that request on the other side, and it will be like consumed by the other side. Similarly, reservation, if you want to cancel, so that also will be done in the asynchronous mode. So you are sending a message right inside the message broker, and that will be again consumed by the other side. So on this particular application, what we have in front, we have the synchronous communication, and in back end we have the asynchronous communication arrangement, right? So many systems nowadays, you take any large system, whether it is like Uber, or it is LinkedIn, or it is Netflix, or any large system you take, so they are actually heavily relying on the asynchronous communication pattern and the volume of messages what they are generating. So it is almost on the line of like trillions of messages they are generating daily. So whether it is Uber, or it is Netflix, or LinkedIn, and many other big players are there. So they are generating trillions of messages, and most of them are carried inside the asynchronous communication-based architecture. Right, we have some more examples also available. So messaging with JMS also. So we'll also have some more details on this JMS related stuff, exactly how we can utilize that in an application. So this is a single message queue based, or we have like multiple this arrangements for carrying the message inside, right? Or we have more interesting example like cab booking system. So there we have again five to six services, and as per the need we have like synchronous communication or like asynchronous communication arrangements integrated in your application, right? So you can check the code of this also later on to exactly understand. It will be easy for you to understand the built-in application code. I believe all of you are comfortable with the object-oriented language, whatever Java or other languages you have used, C++ and all. So you'll be able to understand this code, and for learning, you can also follow the steps given. So that will give you idea about how you can have synchronous or asynchronous communication-based application design. So we are going with a discussion on the concepts of mainly synchronous communication now. So when we talk about the asynchronous operation, so client can be a free, right? Can schedule the work and can be free immediately. And if you have like event-driven architecture, so we'll also have the event-driven architecture for microservices. So in that case, like a client can be also notified for that particular event. So that gives you a freedom to be free when you have initiated some request, and then you don't need to wait for something to happen, right? And we don't expect the clients to be like knowing exactly whereabouts of the other side and what kind of technologies they are using. So that freedom remains everywhere when we talk about this kind of loose coupling. Services are using their own tools and technologies for their operational or functioning of the business logic. And when we have any kind of failure in between, so communication channels are non-functioning, then the in-between, whatever component we call like a message broker, so that can be saving your that particular messages in some way. So there are possibilities how you can retain those messages if there is a kind of communication failure. So the simple fundamental after this is fire and forget, and the rest of this is up to the message broker. So message broker can provide you many facilities. So how you want to have guaranteed message delivery, whether you want to have exact ordering of that, or you want to have a kind of call semantics. So call semantics also is very important when it comes to distributed communication. When your application itself is designed in a distributed way, so your messages are flowing across a larger region where your system components are deployed. So when you make a call, so it can be like at least once, or like exactly once, or maybe you want a kind of idempotent operation, so that should not be repeated. So in some financial transaction based kind of communication, so you need that kind of assurance also. So it should be exactly done once only. So that will be also guaranteed by your message broker. So you can utilize those features of the message brokers. So many such tools are available, or I'll say solutions are available on a large scale, and many systems are having that as a center or core part of their system architecture. So in this case, when we talk about the messages which may be carried inside this messaging architecture, so that can be like a document. So it is simple, your like data only, right? So it can be arriving as a reply to your earlier request which you are sending. Similarly, whenever you are requesting for some function implementation, you want to exploit that. So in that case, it can be called like a command which you are sending. So that also can be treated as a message, or if your architecture is like event driven, so in that case also your event can be treated as a message. So your order or maybe customer, there are certain changes happening with the state of that particular object. So change of that order, so their items are added or removed, and so accordingly that events can be generated. So all this may be treated as a message, and that can be carried inside the architecture, whatever backend components you have. So just recall the concept of smart endpoints and dump pipe. So in this case, again, we are talking about that backend mechanism, what will be carrying your messages from one end to the other end. And we don't have exactly the end declaration also. So we don't have exact endpoint specification. Rather, one side sends a message and maybe other side may be receiving it. And those recipients also can be one or it can be many. In between also, the components can be also not only one, but there can be many such components as per the scale of the application. So that depends on how large is the user base, and like per second, how many messages you want to handle, right? So larger applications like Netflix or maybe Uber, maybe serving like millions of messages per second. So accordingly, they must have their architecture relatively complex. So when we talk about the synchronous calling, so that's obviously like a blocking call and it is tightly coupled. So in this case, we don't have a freedom if you want to like shift one of the side, like application one or application two, if they change sides or they are relocated at some place, then we are lost, because in this case, the endpoints and all are actually known to both the sides. So how to talk with each other. So if we are blocking that, if we are breaking that arrangement, then our communication will fail. So we'll not be able to make a this kind of remote call when you have the synchronous kind of arrangement. So earlier systems were relying on this kind of remote procedure calls, where we have to know exactly that how the endpoints are declared and how you talk to them, and they also should be exactly present at the same time when the request is made, and a response is likely to come back. So both sides exactly should be present. Otherwise, we are lost, and that call will fail, right? But when we talk about asynchronous, so we have the intermediate arrangement. So messaging oriented middleware will be taking care of that. Easily we can have exchange of messages, and we need not worry about whether the message is received by the other side or not. That's a duty of the middleware in between. So that will take care of carrying that message to the other side, and reverse also will be happening. So in this case, we don't have any whereabouts of the other side. Where do they exist? And maybe in what count these applications are implemented, right? So application one or application two, how many instances of that is available, or how many instances of this particular middleware in between? So how many are existing? So that also we do not know as a actual user of this system. There can be multiple occurrences of multiple instances of that application one or application two, or middleware also of the brokers, for example. You can have many instances of that, and without worrying about the failure of your application, you can easily move any instances of application one or application two, or maybe brokers also. You can easily shift their places, because we do not have a tight kind of binding between the whereabouts of application one and application two, and so endpoints and all. So that freedom we have, so we can easily accommodate that kind of change if you have that kind of requirement in your application. So one example in this case is we have like ActiveMQ. So there are many such systems available, whether it is ActiveMQ or it is RabbitMQ, or even on lightweight side, we have Redis data store, in-memory data store. So that also can be providing you like a message queuing system. And on the large scale application, if you have, then Kafka is already there. And otherwise, we have the cloud-based pub-sub systems. So most of the cloud providers also have their own arrangement for providing the asynchronous communication. So there are many possibilities available, either open source or like a subscription-based services to utilize that arrangement. So you can have the flavor of asynchronous communication in your application. So if your application is complex, then you can also have the broker network also, which may be sitting in the center of your application, and that will take all the load of millions of messages which are generated by number of users. So I think I can just try out demonstrating something quickly for ActiveMQ. Let me just check. Am I audible now? Okay. Yes, I was just talking about the active MQ, and there was some process already running on port number 1883. So as I also have that a separate installation of MQTT broker, so that was blocking the actually starting process of this active MQ. So if we just look at this, then although it is a very lightweight solution for messaging, and that is obviously available on port number 61616. You can talk to this particular port if you want to have the GMS related communication. And otherwise, we also have some other protocols. That based communication based on that is also possible. So advanced message queuing protocol, or like this is a simple text oriented messaging, or the MQTT, mostly that is for the IoT domain. Many messaging related protocols, so they are part of this, right? For a simple application, you can be happy with this, or otherwise you can use some other alternates as well. And administration for of this is available on 8161. So if we check that, then we have over here we have all this details available, right? You can have actually the two kinds of destinations when it comes to asynchronous communication, whether it's a kind of a queue, right, or it can be a topic. And then we can also have a list of who are like interested in getting the details which are available in form of message onto either queue or on topics. And you can have some more details also. So from here also, you can send something, drafting a message and specifying actually the destination. So the destinations here, we call it like as a queue, or it can be a topic, right? So either queue or topic, you can select and then draft some request or like a message body and send it to the queue or topic with whatever you are selecting. So accordingly, that will be picked up by your ActiveMQ, this GMS service provider. And then the consumers can actually consume that. So let me just show that also quickly with the command line argument, if I can try this. So I'm using the command line utility for this call. Okay, so we are just trying to send a message in form of a queue onto a queue named as test, and that body is just body equal to queue message, right? And we are passing some credentials also. We are talking to this API straight away, which are again provided as part of the system, ActiveMQ. So message is sent, and now if you want to just again receive this, right? So that is also very simple. But I think before that, I can show the message which has arrived in the, I think, queue we have created, right? Okay, queue name was test, right? Test one or test, it was test. Over here we have generated a message, and that is pending message, right? And message is enqueued, so that is one. And let us again try to consume that. So when we hit this URL with the required parameters. So that should be actually consuming the message. So Q message, that's what the response we get. So message now must have been dequeued from that, right? So message is now dequeued. Okay, so accordingly you can just play with this also from actually your application as well. So you can interact with this particular backend process, so that is running for us, and we can carry messages from the application via this arrangement to the other part of your application, to other service. So that is your communication arrangement in terms of asynchronous communication, right? So there was some quick demo on ActiveMQ, and you can also utilize other protocol related communications in this as well, if that is the need of your application. So here, that's what I was talking about. The messages will be sent to either the topic, or it can be sent to a queue from any of the clients. So there can be n number of clients talking to the other client by having in between the destination. So that destination itself is being managed by your broker in between, or the message service provider, right? So we are sending that to a destination, topic, or queue, and there can be many or one depending on whether you have a queue or you have a topic. So accordingly, it will be targeted to a specific consumer, or it can be targeted to a like n number of consumers. So that is one to many, or like one to one, and there are several other features also as per your quality of service requirements and the application is in need of that. So you can also explore some other such service related parameters also. So that's just PubSub. We have multiple subscribers topic. You can subscribe to that and also receive as and when something happens in under that topic. Or you have queue, so that is one-to-one message delivery, and accordingly it will be removed from that particular queue. So that's just either point to point, or like one to this one to many kind of communication requirements for your application. So I think we'll stop here for today for this session, and we'll continue with this in the next session. If you have any queries, I'll wait for some time and then we'll stop. There is some question. Yes, I think Pujan also has asked that question, and Shubh is also asking that whether we need to implement a front end in the innovative assignment. Okay, so your front end may not be very rich, like. But you should have some kind of a front end to talk with your application. I'll not say that it should be very good rendered page with a kind of all those requirements for aesthetic and all. So not that colored and all. But I'll say there should be some kind of basic interface which should be allowing like how you can talk to your service, whether it is internal services or in front you have placed some service. So there should not be a very heavy service, but you can have a very simple service which will allow a user to talk to. So not very rich interface, but simple interface is expected. Yes, it can be like a substitute of Postman. That is also fine. But we should not be posting something separately like what we do in Postman, right? So if you need to post something, so you should not be able to, we should be able to rather do it right from the interface. Any other query, anyone with the contents of what we have gone through today or any project related query?